Today on Between the Lines, overcoming fear so you can live life to the fullest with Olympia LePoint. Welcome, I'm Barry Kibrick. Olympia is an award-winning rocket scientist involved in over 20 space shuttle missions. Her TED lecture on overcoming fear is a major hit, and with her book, Mathaphobia, Olympia goes beyond overcoming the fear of math and shows how we have the power within us to deal with our anxieties and turn them into an empowering force.
I'm a writer today because I was a reader when I was 11 years old, and it was...
You do not need to prove your state of happiness to anybody.
Most of these speeches were as much as a month in preparation.
Characters, the heroes in this book, are seekers of truth in a story that involves a lot of corruption.
I don't get a chance to really talk about what's real, and it's the perfect thing to do.
Olympia, it is a pleasure to welcome you to Between the Lines. I've had many rocket scientists and physicists on the show. I must admit, they didn't quite look the same.
Thank you so much, Barry. It is my pleasure to be on your show.
And in fact, that's actually part of how you even begin your TED lecture. You walk out as this woman that no one expects to be, and you admit it. You say, you know, I've launched 28 space shuttle missions, and you give this phenomenal TED lecture on fear and how to overcome it. And that's what first attracted me. And then your book about fear, in that particular case, is about math fear. But as I told you earlier in the green room, we can use it just to discuss fear. It's that relevant.
Yes. Fear is something that everyone has overcome. No matter who you are, fear is what stops us from becoming successful. In my book, Mathaphobia, and also in my TEDx lecture, Reprogramming the Brain to Overcome Fear, I talk about the three steps to overcome fear so you can do anything you want. And in my case, I became a rocket scientist, but that was only after I learned the process of what fear was and how to reject it, then a way to reprogram my brain, and lastly, how to take the steps that I needed in order to accomplish what it was that I needed to do.
And I think if there's one message I want to make sure that everyone takes home, including myself and you and the viewers, is that we're not talking ever about eliminating fear. You can never eliminate the most primal emotion that we have as human beings. It's what we can do once we have that fear to overcome it, to conquer it, to fight through it. That's what's the fascinating thing.
The fascinating thing is exactly what you said. Fear will always exist, but the question is, will we choose to accept it or reject it? That's the question. In my life, surprisingly, people are shocked. I became an award-winning rocket scientist, but I failed algebra, I failed geometry, I failed calculus and chemistry in high school, and people are completely shocked. And I had a teacher in my 11th grade and 12th grade year that showed me how to study and how to invest in myself in education. And it was through that process I recognized that fear was a choice. And fear, once we knew what it was, we could remove it. But it required us to name it. And in my book, I talk about what mathophobia is. And what mathophobia is, it's a severe fear that happens in the reptilian part of the brain that shuts off the frontal brain lobes from working. And when that happens, someone's incapable of solving problems. Yeah.
And you make certain to let us know that it's not our fault.
Yes.
See, that's where I think people have the most problems, is they begin to blame themselves for this fear.
Yes.
And then that puts them in a vicious downward cycle. And that's why you say, name it, face it.
Yes.
You know, am I right? That's because otherwise, by not doing that, you spiral downward rather than lift upward.
I am fortunate. I completely agree with you. I am fortunate. I have had the ability to teach at the college level as a professor in mathematics. And throughout the years of teaching mathematics, I saw this type of characteristic that was happening in the individuals. And then later, when I started my own educational corporation, I started seeing the same patterns of these individuals that have this fear. And so it was surprising. I decided to name them. And I named them based on what they were doing. The first person was Quincy the Quitter. Quincy is a person who will quit before he even tries. The next person is Donna the overdoer. Donna is someone who tries and tries and tries, but she still misses the mark. The next person is Samuel the struggler, who is brilliant, but he struggles to understand how other people see things, so he has trouble explaining himself. And the last person is Crystal the criticizer. She will blame everyone for her poor performance because she doesn't know how to become a beginner again.
I want to follow all of those, but before we even do, I want to get into this part because I think it'll set up all those, and that is that the effects of fear, even though it is something that is real but within us, you say that what compounds it is it's invisible because we befriend it. We almost become as if the fear is off. I don't know how to say it, but it becomes within us. It becomes more than befriended even. It gets embedded within us.
Yes. In my book, I share my own personal story. And in chapter one, as well as the last chapter, I bring it to a full circle. And in my own personal life, I had to learn how to reject fear in my own life. I was a person that was raised in a poverty-stricken area in South Central Los Angeles. At the age of 10, I was in a classroom and I had my face sliced open by a gang member. And I was in an educational environment where I was never expected to go to a college or university. And in that process, I was befriending fear. I was accepting it in my own life. And I was so much accepting it that I didn't think that there was any other option for hope. And it wasn't until I was busted into another area with a predominantly a different socioeconomic class of individuals and students did I realize that I actually had choices. And part of that choice was, did I choose to continuously think that everyone else's problem is what would prevent me from being successful, or was I going to be courageous and not decide to follow the same path in which was destined or supposedly predestined in the area in which I grew up?
Well, when you said that the first thing you did was find that fear, name it. And that in itself, by the way, once you do that, you begin the empowerment, I from what I gather through the lectures and through the book. But then you go on and you say, we must though now, once we do that, we have to reprogram our brain and literally fill them with different thoughts. Because as we said, we can't eliminate the fear, but we can fill our brain with different thoughts of how we're going to overcome them.
Yes. I look at the brain as a computer system. Now, I was very fortunate and I launched 28 missions into outer space through the Space Shuttle NASA's program. And in that process, I saw engineering close up. I saw all the temperature spikes, the pressure spikes that would prevent a launch, and what would stop it from being successful. What type of failures were in the system that would potentially reprogram the engine in order for it to self-destruct? And then I started looking at this with the human brain. There's parts of us that can self-destruct our own way of thinking. And when I looked at the brain as a operating system, a computerized system that is responsible for allowing us to be successful, then that's when I realized that we have the ability, just like a computer program, to reboot our brain so it does operate the way in which it has designed to solve problems and allow us to be successful. And in that process of rebuilding the thoughts, like for example, if there's a person that is scared of mathematics, so in my book, Mathaphobia, it's specifically geared towards college students and pre-college students and returning students who want to overcome their fear of mathematics. And in the book, Quincy the Quitter is someone who quits before you even try. So he will have these thoughts in his head of failure. He will think, I'm not going to get any help if I ask. Or he will have some other thought of mind of, if I try, I'm going to fail, so why should I start? And so these are self-destructive thought processes that are attached to fear and not his own thinking, not the way that his brain was designed to think. So when he's able to identify what that fear is, he becomes empowered, and then he's able to reprogram his brain by, instead of thinking, oh, I'm going to fail immediately when I try, he'll think, I'm going to reject that thought. Rather, I'm going to start this, and I may not get it all at first, but I will get some of it. And each time I go, and each time I move, and each time I go towards trying to understand a little bit piece of more of it, I will understand it. And when he decides to have that mind frame, when he decides to choose that way of thinking, he thus is reprogramming his brain. And he's creating neurons in his brain to actually create pathways so his frontal brain lobe begins to work.
And yet, you still take it one step further. You take it out of our head, and you say, we must rebuild the brain, but we do so by taking action.
Taking action.
Take action. In fact, you say specifically in direct opposition to your fear. Now, I do think is probably the toughest part, but anytime you take action, it's a lot tough. It's very easy to do everything up in here, you know? It just is.
Oh, yes.
It is. But taking that action and then in direct opposition of your fear, I almost feel liberated just by saying those words.
Great. And my goal is for the American population and international population to understand that there's a choice and there's a liberation to removing fear.
You tell us, learn to become a beginner again.
Learn
so the direction could be simply start over.
Start
it over and go in the opposite of your fear.
Exactly. And I learned that personally. I remember when I left Rocket Science, I decided to leave and I went to a prestigious banking organization. And I was using mathematics to prevent a currency shortage. But I recognized that although the math was fun to use and I was applying it in a new way, I was passionate about science and education, in mathematics specifically. And I took the bold move to leave, but the economy tanked across the United States. And then I was teaching part-time, and there was no full-time opportunities across the United States because no one was hiring. And that's when I had to learn to become a beginner again, and it was tough, because I had to redefine myself independent of what others thought, but how I saw myself.
But you give us a little clue to that, because although we've been talking a lot about up here, you say open your heart and open your brain. That sounds like one of those times when you opened your heart first and then the brain opened up.
Yes. I happen to be a very spiritual person. And I remember praying, and I remember thinking to myself, praying and asking, where do I go now? How do I help people? I was helping people before by launching rockets. How do I help people now? And I received, share with people how you overcame your own fear. And that was the most challenging and exciting task in front of me, because I remember for years people would ask me, how did you get out of the hood? How did you get out of gang violence? How did you change your life around? And I used to be upset when people would ask me that question, because I thought I didn't owe them an explanation. But in reality, I did. I owed the explanation to others, especially the next generation, to know how to be successful in education, but most importantly, I owed it to myself. I needed to know how I did it. I realized that I had to fully understand how I changed my own situation and how I will be able to continuously change my future for the better. And only after I understood that is when I was able to share it with other people.
In the book, you do a little rift. And actually, it's not a little rift. It's only a little rift because of the way I put it in my notes. But I'll rift it anyway that way. In the book, it's actually, they go far apart. But I loved it as a little riff, okay? So I'm going to play that with you, if you don't mind. And it had to do with the words divorce and marry.
Oh.
And it goes like this. And it says, first thing, I'll just give it in the order that it was. It was divorce, compulsion, remarry, freedom.
That was for Donna the Overdoer. And Barry, I thank you so much for looking deeply in my book and figuring out and picking out that piece that is so pivotal for changing each one of these characters into be someone else. Divorcing fear and remarrying freedom is the highlight to change each one of these problem associate characters into someone else. For example, it's so amazing. When I think about all these scenarios, I think about my own life. But for example, Donna the Overdoer, when she is able to divorce the hardship and remarry freedom and divorce this compulsion that she has, she becomes Sarah the Strategist. And in Donna's case, she is a person who is an overachiever. And surprisingly, I find that 75 to 80% of college students are Donna the Overdoer. Donna is a person that is used to succeeding at everything that she does. And when she misses the mark or when she doesn't get it right, she beats herself up. And she thinks, the more time I spend into it next time and the more I dedicate to it, I've got to do it extensively. She then essentially shoots herself in the foot because she is not stepping back and looking at the big picture and understanding that there's a strategy to solving problems. And if the way didn't work before, there may be a better way that may work, so she doesn't have to spend all her time and energy into being this person who is married to this compulsion.
Let's take some more divorces then, because this is kind of fun. So you also then say divorce stigma, because yes. Doesn't that come along with the fear is stigma, and marry respect.
Ah, and that is specifically given for Samuel the Struggler. Samuel is a brilliant thinker, and